resurrection.
Amen.
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 Good afternoon, everybody.
Good afternoon.
This afternoon, I would like to give everybody a challenge. To think, for maybe some of you, I don't know, a few, to think about becoming a Christian. And for most of you, I challenge you to stay strong in the faith, in the Christian faith. To stay strong in the Christian faith in spite of the fact that you are struggling. To stay strong in the Christian faith in spite of the fact that you know some Christians who make things difficult for you. To stay strong in the faith in spite of the fact that perhaps the churches that you have been to have disappointed you. To stay strong in the faith, perhaps the elders and the pastors have offended you. I challenge you to stay strong in the faith, even if you have not been feeling well, even if you have some prayers that you feel have not been answered. I challenge you to be strong in the faith, even if you struggle in your own behavior. You struggle with all your own temptations. Many struggles, and you have so many questions that have not been answered. I challenge you to stay strong in the faith, because our faith is never based on people's behavior. It's never based on how much we understand about the Bible and all the doctrine. It's never based on how we feel, because our faith is founded and based on our Lord Jesus Christ, who have already proven himself to us that he can be trusted, because he came, he was perfect, he died on the cross, and he rose on the third day. So I challenge you to embrace Christianity. For whatever the world say against Christianity, to stay strong in the faith, however you feel, because of Jesus Christ, and to consider that. And that is why we are focused today on the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The foundation of our Christian faith is not our behavior, how we do, because otherwise we will all be out of here. You know, the foundation is not correct answers and knowing all the right theology, because nobody knows everything God does. The foundation of our faith is the belief that our Lord Jesus Christ died on the cross. He was buried, and he rose again, and he is alive today. That is the foundation of our faith. So it doesn't matter how you think, how you feel, but I challenge you to embrace, because this is about you. This is about you and your Lord Jesus Christ. To embrace that, and if you are already a Christian, to stay strong in the faith. The reason why Christian faith has stayed for so many years, from the time of Jesus Christ until now. So you wonder, how come that the Christian faith has stayed until now? When you see that there are struggles, when you see that, you know, the history is not that great, we have a lot of issues in our history, but how come one-third of the population of the world is Christian, and it's going on and moving on? Billions are, for centuries, have stayed Christian when this church was started by a man who is just a plain son of a carpenter. How come? Now, when we look at movements in our history, we see that there is a pattern. There is, as John is saying, there's a logic to how movements begin. For example, many years ago, there was a man named Muhammad who was born in Arab states. The Arabians were worshipping idols. And Muhammad has come to a point of this thinking, understanding that there is only one God. That's Muhammad, you know that. And he came and he began to preach this. He began to preach and he began to teach people that no such thing as idol. And people began to believe what he's saying. And then they began, you know, they started forming their own armies. They started a movement, you know, which we call now Islam. It's a fascinating story. And then he died. And when he died, the movement didn't stop there. The movement continued because they say, they were saying, whoa, all of these teachings of Muhammad, somebody's got to continue. And then they formed armies and so forth. And then they continued to grow and grow into other nations, using force, using swords, and grew that movement. You know, man rose up. There was a time in the history of the United States when there was so much prejudice, there was so much discrimination, no civil rights, but a man rose up and saw the inequity and saw the prejudice, and a man rose up, and this man is a little different because he preached non-violence. And then he was killed, Martin Luther King. But then his legacy continued on because of what he preached, non-violence. When you look at the history of the world, we see how movements begin. Some are good, some are bad. A lot of them are bad. Hitler, there was a problem in Europe. There was confusion, there was economic depression, there were abuses. And so Hitler used that. He rose and he began to preach. And then he preached, again using, in this case, also violence, going into outside of Germany, and then also and so forth, trying to promote Nazism. I don't have to go through all this. Basically, here is the pattern in movement. We have a problem, you know, that's going on. And then a man or a woman rise up and address that problem and begin to tell them of some new ideas and new concepts and philosophies, and people listen. And then they, most of them choose to rise up and rebel, and there's a revolution. Rise up and raise up arms and perhaps form some army, rise up and do a revolution, and they overthrow. I mean, isn't that most of the story? I mean, that's how movements happen. You know, that's how it is. Unrest. Then there are factions, there are divisions, and somebody rises up to give an inspiration, introducing chains. Chains, you know, let's have a chains. Enough movement, and then they have enough people to overthrow the status quo. And then that person becomes a legend, that person dies, and then ideas are, you know, continued by the followers. And that's basically how it is. Mao Zedong, in the same way, did the same thing. That kind of formula, that's the logic, that's the flaw of it. Now that formula does not fit Christianity. It does not work with Christianity. Because with Jesus Christ, he was different. From the minds of the people who would look at Jesus at this particular time, when Jesus Christ opened his mouth and started to preach, his message was problematic. Because for the people of that time, the people of these days, the message of Jesus to them was opposite of the standard, you know, formula. He did not ask for people to raise up arms. He didn't ask people to gather and form into armies and to get their swords. Jesus Christ didn't do that. He didn't ask people to go against Rome, because Rome was tyrannical. What? I mean, the people there were just looking forward for a man to address the problem of tyranny, for a man to rise and form a revolution. And so they were waiting and waiting. Their mind is so fixated on that kind of logic of revolution to overthrow the Roman Empire. They were just looking forward to that. And then Jesus Christ came. You know the story, and he was riding a donkey. Yeah. And then he came in, right, and said to people, pay your taxes to Caesar. But like what? You know? They were expecting somebody to pay your taxes. And then he came into the temple, and he began to upset the temple. He began to throw away all the symbols of worship. I mean, because, you know, the Jews, they were so much into the nationalism and their form of religion. And here's a guy who seems to say, pay your taxes? And then, what? He upset the temple? So the message of Jesus Christ was problematic for them. E tu vas. Then he said, what did he say? My kingdom is not of this world. And then he went to Pilate. And Pilate was not threatened, right? Remember he was with Pilate, the story? And Pilate said, I don't find anything wrong with this man. You know, I can't find anything that's dangerous. I cannot find anything to accuse this Jesus. He's not a rebel. He's not a threat to Rome. Because Jesus obeyed the laws. He obeyed the laws of the Roman Empire. He paid taxes. Even he was that way. And even with the Jews, the Jewish rules, he didn't come and he obeyed the laws. He obeyed the Ten Commandments. Did he not? He obeyed them. That's Jesus. In fact, he raised the standards even of the law. That's what Jesus did. Because of Jesus, and that's why Christianity is, I want to present something, Christianity is different from all the movements. It is so different. Jesus did not come for us to rise up and to overthrow governments. That's not the message of Jesus Christ. In fact, it is so different because here's the problem in the mind of the people. Unlike other revolutionaries who have their own teachings, Jesus Christ's message was all about Jesus. That's his message. It's about himself. He never asked people to trust, you know, okay, I have a set of rules and code of rules here for you, and hand them this code of rules. So when I am gone, here is what you will do, this code of rules. That's what you have to do. That's not what Jesus Christ did. That's not. It's just different. He preached and he was showing people who the Messiah is. The Messiah. Let me go to Matthew 16, verse 13. Matthew 16, verse 13. Matthew 16, verse 13. So when Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, who do people say the Son of Man is? So again, this is the question of Jesus. Who do you think I am? He calls himself the Son of Man. It's a who question. They replied, some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets. But what about you? He is asking. What about you? He asked. Who do you say I am? And Simon Peter answered, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus replied, whoa, you know, you didn't just think about that, Peter. Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by man, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you lose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Then he warned his disciples not to tell anymore that he was the Christ. So here we can see in this story, Jesus saying, you are right as far as your understanding. What is most important for us to understand is that Jesus Christ is indeed the Messiah. He is the Son of Man. He is the one that is sent. Now, God told you that, Peter. It's not from your imagination or what, but it is God who revealed that to you. And I'm going to tie this in why this is really important. For us to look and to focus on Jesus Christ. So when Jesus first walked into that situation with the disciples, he was leading them to what is really important is to focus on Jesus, and that is himself. Not because here is what happened. It has been proven for so many years. The Jews, for hundreds of years have held on to the law of Moses, to the Ten Commandments, to this code of conduct. You know, that's what they held on to. And as a proof, it didn't help them, because the law cannot save them. You know, rules of conduct, rules of behavior, they don't save us. There is one Savior. Notice in Galatians 3:19. Galatians 3:19. And I have a point for us that I wanted to make here. Galatians 3:19. What then was the purpose of the law? So, okay, here's a question. Paul said, do you know why the law was given? Why the law was this code, this ethics of rules or code of rules, you know, the whole thing. Do you know why the law was written? What is the purpose? It was added because of transgressions until the seed to whom the promise referred had come. What he's saying is that God has given us the law so that we see sin, our sinfulness. Like, you know, you walk out in the street or you come to the house and you didn't realize you have a lot of dirt on the face. You know, you walk, you know, with a lot of dirt. And then wife says, hey, you know, here's your mirror. And then you look at the mirror, and by the mirror, you see dirt on the face. That's what the law is. When you see the law, oh, I've been sinning. And the purpose of that is for us to see, whoa, we have this, you know, and the wages of sin is death, and I need somebody to cleanse me. I need somebody to, you know, to help me. So the law is like a mirror. You know, it is not to save us. There's so many families. One of the problems among Christian church is that we have kids who grow up in church. We have kids who grow up, and then as parents, we totally mistake and we teach our children so much of the law. We teach our children how to behave, to follow certain codes, certain rules. Don't do this, don't do that. And so our kids are so behaved in the church because they follow these rules. But they don't have a relationship with the one, with Jesus Christ. And so when the kids grow up and they go to college, we lose a lot of them because they go to college and they're presented by all other kinds of philosophies and code and rules there. And they replace what kind of code we teach them with what the world has to say, because there's nothing that connects them that is so sticky, you know. It is just a code or rules. Rules, that's why we lose a lot of our young people. Because they go and we think that they are good. Oh, I've done a good job because they behave well. But that is the thing. They're just looking at that code of rules, not on this gospel, which is Christ. So the problem with the message in the mind of people when they look at Jesus was, you know, whoa, this is totally different. Jesus' message was about Jesus. He was the center of his own attention, and he placed himself at the center so that we can look at and, whoa, he's the Messiah. The message of Jesus is Jesus. The teachings of Jesus is not just some kind of rules of conduct. You know, all the other movements. Because if you say, oh, I don't agree with you, Pastor, I say, hold on to the ways, all under these rules of conduct, okay, you do that, then you become nothing. The same thing with all the other movements and philosophies of the world, because they are clinging on to just rules and regulations, and there is no God, there is no person. You know what I mean? And it can easily be replaced. That's why I think that, you know, the time has come when God wants us to see this is really sticky, this is so important that it's never too late for us parents or grandparents to make sure that the people that we work, that we deal with, don't just get rules and regulations, but they truly understand who God is, the nature of God, and they have that relationship. That's Jesus. And then they're confused, so the disciples are still confused about this. I mean, you know, we've read so much Bible study, they could not fully understand the gospel, right? I mean, you know, in the story, even until the book of Acts, because they had their mind on Rome and revolution. And so they said, okay, Show us the Father then. You know, let's go to John 14, verse 9. Show us, you know, who you are. Show us who's the Father that you're talking about. Now in John 14, 9, Jesus says, let me give you another kind of word or understanding, a picture of what God is like. Okay, this is for you and me. A picture of what God is like, because that's what's most important, what God is like. And then in John 14:9 it says, anyone, Jesus says, anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. Again, this teaching is pointing to what? Jesus, right? Pointing to Him. And this is very important, especially if you have this Christianity. If you're listening now, maybe you have this expression, but maybe not, maybe but in your heart, maybe we're thinking this way. If you have this Christianity, or maybe perhaps you have wavered, or perhaps you walk away and you're considering, you know, other philosophies, I mean, this is important. Never once did Jesus, nor in his followers here, you know, came to, you know, Jesus Christ did not teach that Christianity is just a collection of parables, stories, insights, principles to pass on to the next generation. Because that is how Israel failed. They look at their religion and their faith merely as a collection of the Torah, collection of the prophets and all of this, and totally miss that. That's why Christ has to come and to give them the new covenant, and the new covenant is Jesus Himself. So the problem in the mind is that, you know, the message of Jesus is a problem to them because the message of Jesus is Himself. And it is not liberating. It is not revolutionary. He didn't start something new where they can overturn the Roman Empire, where they can go against Augustus, but he kept talking about himself, about the Father. So when Jesus died, because he was talking about himself, when Jesus died, they lost hope. What happened when he was arrested in the garden? What happened? They scattered, they ran away, because they were looking and hoping for that formula, that logic that John is saying in their mind, a revolutionary, right? So when he died, run, right? Run, that's what happened. And when Jesus died, all his messages became not important anymore, because his message they were holding before it, these teachings of Jesus, they were embracing because they were looking at Jesus to be the revolutionary. You know, all the things that Jesus said, the messages of Jesus, you know, all the claims that he did, and then he died. Yeah. So somehow when he died, when the leader died, they scattered because of what use are this collection if there is no leader? Yeah. So they run away and no one anymore believed his claims. Mm-hmm. They run. They doubted because they didn't understand. When Jesus died, that movement died. So when he was on the crucifixion, only his immediate friend and family, but all the rest of the church, which is the disciples. Where was the church? Gone. Jesus was the movement. He was the message. He was in the center. And so when he died, they were gone. Because they're holding on to something that is not permanent. You know? Something that can be replaced. That was the problem. So, that's the story of Jesus. Because in their minds, they say, Messiah. Messiahs don't die. Because Jesus claimed to be a Messiah. The Son of God cannot be killed. Because Jesus claimed to be the Son of God. Right? And they say, the way, the truth, and the life cannot die, because Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So all of these teachings of Jesus, I'm not saying they're not important, they are important. But they're only important as much as there is Jesus alive. Because if Jesus Christ did die and stay dead, all of these teachings and the way, the resurrection, and everything that he said are nothing if there is no resurrection. Right? It will be nothing. So that's why they run. Yeah. You know, that's And so the resurrection of Jesus Christ is what kept Christianity. Without the resurrection, what faith do we have?
Yeah.
It is when Jesus Christ died. And how did it happen? Well, let's go to, here's what God says. John 20, verse 1. So will you allow me a few more minutes?
Because
time is right. Okay, John 20, verse 1. Here's how it was unfolded. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. It's very important. During the time, women were second-class citizens. Women, in fact, during that time, cannot be witnesses in court. Did you know that? In the tradition then, women cannot be witnesses in court. This is very interesting. Why is it interesting? Because the people who were writing this, you know, if you were to write a story and you want to convince people, you want to write a story and to make sure that you have men as witnesses. But so why is it that the writers here put women as the witnesses? Well, because women were the witnesses. It's that simple. They were just honest about it. So you can even see here that it's a proof. A proof that there is originality and there is truth in the writers, because even if it seems weak from that particular generation that the witness are women, they still wrote it. It doesn't matter, because that is the truth. So Mary, they went back, because you know, short time before that, there were men who wrapped Jesus, and there were men who carried him and put the spices and brought him to the tomb. And of course, women knows that whenever men do the job, women have to do it again. it's not perfect, right? So women said, "Oh, we have to go back and let's see how the men, you know, they did well." But anyway, so they went to the tomb. And the stone was removed. You know, sometimes people think that Jesus rose and the stone was moved so that Jesus can go out. No, no, no. There was no need for the stone to be moved so Jesus can go out, because as you see in the upper room later on, Jesus walks through walls. So the stone was removed so that the disciples can get in. Right? That's the reason. So here we see the women were given that responsibility in this case. So let me go again. So she came in verse 2, she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciples, the one Jesus loved, and said, this is important. What did Mary Magdalene say? They have taken the Lord out of the tomb and we don't know where they have put it. Mary Magdalene didn't know about the resurrection. What did she say? They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they put him. So they don't understand yet the resurrection yet, even at this moment. So why is this important? Because Mary Magdalene didn't go running. She didn't go running to the disciples and she said, "Disciples, he is risen from the dead." You know, she didn't say that. Nobody expected Jesus' resurrection. Even so many times Jesus said it, they never expect. Because if they did expect the resurrection, you know what? They will be outside the tomb. They will be out there waiting. And they will be doing 10, 9 fireworks. Clothes coming in and music, you know. Hallelujah. They would have done that, right? But no, nobody was there. Nobody. Except Jesus, he came out. So nobody knew. They did not know. And so what happened? So when Jesus said, it's an empty tomb. Now did the disciples say, "Hallelujah, he's risen"? No. You know, if you look at in Luke 24, verse 11, it says, Luke 24, 11, "But they," the men, "did not believe the women, because their words seemed like to them nonsense." See, they would not, even the men at the time have a problem. They do not accept the testimony of women. That's how discriminating, that even the disciples were. They discriminated and they did not accept. So the men didn't say, praise God for the resurrection. They listened to the women and they said, you're crazy. So they went to, you know, and probably say, women, maybe they went to the wrong tomb. It's kind of, you know, that's why we don't want them in court. So in John 20, verse 3, continuing the story, John 20, verse 3, and so Peter and the other disciple, now this is John writing, the other disciple is himself, you know, I kind of find this a little funny because Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb, both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter. He's not saying, I can run faster than Peter. He didn't have to say that, right? But he ran, said, the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. Verse 4. He bent over, referring to himself as John, he bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. So John was faster in running, got in, he looked, and then did not go in. Why didn't he go in? Because it was a tomb. You know? When I was young, I had this fear of coffin. You know, I never attended memorial funeral services when I was growing. You know, the first one that I went to in a funeral was the one I officiated. Seriously, I have a phobia. And then I became a trainee, ministerial intern in the Philippines. I arrived, and then I got a call and said, Bernie, somebody died. Go and officiate the ceremony. My name is Richard Hussein. So I understand John here, you know. He looked inside and didn't want to get in because of that phobia. But that was, you know, my phobia is gone now. I'm so used to it now. Anyway, it happens. So here we see John looking and he did not. Then continuing in verse 6, let me just speed this up. Then Simon Peter came along behind him, but Peter's different, right? Came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. You know, it shows that, hey, if they stole the body, you're going to steal the body in a hurry. You don't have to remove the linen. All of that. You can't grab the whole body, the whole thing. But this one was, you know, all of this, and in other places, even folded some of this. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. And finally, the other disciple, which is him, the writer, you know, I didn't say I, a very modest person, right? The other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. Now, this is what I want to emphasize in this message this afternoon. He saw and believe. It's very important. John the disciple, after so many years being with Jesus, listening to the teachings of Jesus, all messages, seeing miracles about Jesus, all of this, and even the arrest of Jesus and having heard of the crucifixion, finally what made him believe? What made John believe? It wasn't the teachings. It wasn't, you know, probably he was confused, you know, even at that moment. It wasn't even the miracles. They were still struggling because they had a concept that is different. It wasn't even the crucifixion. Because during the crucifixion, they ran away, right? They didn't go and embrace the cross and what, you know, fall or whatever and preach the gospel. No, the crucifixion happened and they ran away. It was the empty tomb. It was the resurrection that made John, and then later on, all of the apostles and disciples, all of them, believe. I don't have time, but it says in John 16, verse 8 to 15, that the sin of the world, the greatest sin of the world, is the sin of unbelief. You can check that in John 16, 8 to 15. You know, we tend to think of all this sin management or behavior modification. Those are sin, but from God's perspective, the sin of unbelief is the sin of the world. So Jesus' followers got re-engaged. They re-engaged with the message of Jesus, not because of the sermons, not even because of the miracles. I'm not saying they're not important. They were important, but with the disciples, they got re-engaged in Christian life. Their faith became stronger, firm, because of what they saw, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. As I said, the crucifixion was not even enough to convince them. Jesus' followers didn't re-engage because of the teachings alone. They were not fully convinced, but they got re-engaged when they saw Jesus alive. From death to alive. That is fascinating. When we look at the story, that's why is it, I asked the question earlier, that the Christian church continues and the gates of hell cannot prevail against it? It's because Jesus is alive. He is in charge. He leads us. He is in the lives of people. You know He's alive because you can sense Him in your life. The resurrected Jesus. That's our Lord. And that to me is powerful. And even Paul in 1 Corinthians 15, maybe I'll go to the last scripture or two here. 1 Corinthians 15, verses 1 to 4. If you summarize the teachings and the gospel of Paul, it is here. 1 Corinthians 15, 1 to 4. Now, brothers, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you. Okay? Paul wrote many things. Many, even rules of conduct. Paul, it's a lot of epistles. But here, now, brothers, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you received and which you have taken your stand. This is what we stand. This is where our faith is based on. By this gospel, you are saved. If you hold firmly to the word I preach to you, otherwise you have believed in vain. For what I receive, I pass on to you as of first importance. So this is what's important, he's saying. That Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. There is the summation of the gospel. But the most important part is the understanding that our Lord, our Savior, Jesus Christ, died. He really died. And then he rose again, and he is alive. Do not make that as a little thing. Because we often make other things bigger than the very gospel. And that's why we lose people. That's why we get discouraged. Because when you're so much focused on what you can do, you know, to behave on our conduct and following rules, if that's all your focus, a time will come when you get so discouraged and then you leave. Your faith weakens because you're holding on to certain code of rules and you get discouraged because you say, I can't do this. I can't. Because really, God says, you can't, really. That's why he sent his son, Jesus. It is only in Jesus where we can be saved. It's only in him. And of course, our behavior follows after that. I'm not saying you behave wrongly, no. Because when you understand Jesus, and you have such great relationship with him living in us, then we respond, you know, well. That's why even in Acts, when Peter was preaching, he was preaching this gospel, and he was saying to them, you know, the message, when they found that Jesus, he was alive, and then in the book of Acts, there were only four things. The four things, the message of the apostles, you know, to the people. When he preached, in Acts chapter 2, here's what Peter said to the people there. And some of these people were even saying, maybe crucify him just a few days ago, right? And here's what Peter said. You people, You killed him.
When you read that, when you're in Acts 2.
But God raised him up. We have seen him. Now say you're sorry. You know, repent. And Acts 3:15, it says, you killed the author of life, his Peter, but God raised him from the dead, and we are witnesses of this. You see, it is what convinced Peter about Christianity and the faith is this. And it is what Peter and Paul started preaching more to the people. It is the gospel. That's what it is. In fact, they understood in Revelation 1, John says, Jesus holds the keys to the Hades and the grave, you know, of death. He has the keys. Meaning, you throw him in grave, he has the keys to open it. That's why when Jesus is with you, he has the keys. You're thrown in the grave, in the Hades and hell, but Jesus has the keys. He said, okay, let me take you out. That's how it is, you know, in Revelation. Revelation 1:18, Jesus holds the keys. And so there, you know, you can move on. You don't have to be afraid of death because Jesus has keys. Death is only fearful, scary, if we don't have keys to get out. Yeah. But Jesus has the keys. So here, so people were, finally when they had the message, you know, they had the message of Peter, oh yeah, okay, we killed, or we're sorry, whatever. What shall we do now in Acts 2:38? What should we do? What should we do? And after hearing of Jesus, they were asking, what should we do? And then Peter said, repent. Change your mind. Repent, because you have been so focused on, you can do works. You can save yourself. Change your mind. You cannot. You know, focus on Jesus. That's his message. Every one of you, repent in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. Acts 16:30, same thing with Paul. The jailer said to Paul, what should I do? And Paul said, believe in the resurrected Jesus. That's the message. And so, the message for us that I want to leave with you today is that the resurrection of Jesus is the foundation of our faith. Jesus is the message. And we may not have seen Jesus like the apostles, but we experience Jesus now in our own lives. I do, and I have seen that. The book of Acts tells of 500 people who saw him. And I can say I can see people in this hall who live with him, with Jesus. John 14:19, here's final scripture where Jesus says, for you and I, Jesus says, because I live, you too shall live also. And isn't that a very comforting? Jesus said, because I live, you also live. That is the foundation. That is the basis of our faith. For you who are weakening right now in your faith, I challenge you, give Jesus Christ another chance. I challenge you to embrace Jesus Christ. Give him another chance. Not because of the offenses that you have received from people who are as weak as we are. Not because you have been offended by Christians or disappointed by churches. It has nothing to do with our faith. God loves you so much. It's not about those the precious rules and regulations we hold on to. No, it is God's tremendous love for you. And he wants you. Give God another chance. Embrace him. And in spite of everything else, be strong in the faith. Because as Jesus said, because I live, you also live. Amen.
Amen.